Welcome to worship this third week of Advent. May it be a joyful one for you. Thank you, Julie, for being with us today, and for Marcus and Mark and Desiree and Maria as our quartet, and for our choir, for you all being with us to help with our musical leadership today. Thank you so much. You may be wondering where Peter Bates is this morning. He came down with COVID this past week. He's fine, but he's still testing positive. And as the church policy is, if you're positive, you don't come back until 10 days. So hopefully he will have his negative results before the 10 days, but he definitely will be back with us next Sunday, which is perfect because he will not only be here for worship, but he's having a recital that afternoon, and we're having a carol sing at 4 o'clock here in this sanctuary. We hope that you'll be with us that day. If you're worshiping with us virtually, you can also join virtually in that carol sing. It will be streamed just as we stream this service of worship. Today, moviegoers will be going to see The Fablemans for the 105 showing at the AMC Marketplace. If you want to go, we'll meet you there. If you want to buy tickets ahead of time before you leave today, Amy can get those set up for you. You can see her after worship. And if you're not able to join us, we just encourage you to enjoy the movie at your leisure. It is Steven Spielberg's semi-autobiographical story of he and his family. There are three different opportunities that are special for this season for you to make an impact. The first one is if you would like to give in support of Rising Tides children and youth gift giving, that would be wonderful. They receive gifts from Rising Tide that Covenant makes possible for them. For some of the young people, it will be the only gifts that they give. Typically, we give an article of clothing or something warm, something to encourage creativity, and then one or two toys. If you'd like to make a donation to help support our purchase of those items, you can do so by going to our website and clicking on the Give button and notating gifts, or you can make a donation directly to the church through cash or a check. Also, if you'd like to purchase toys, you can do that, and you can drop them off here at the church or Shea Bacchus, which is a restaurant at the corner of 4th and Olive, and they are doing a toy drive in support of Rising Tide this season. Second, if you would like to purchase poinsettias to help beautify our sanctuary, our hope is to have 24 more poinsettias here by next Sunday to finish off Advent and lead us into Christmas. They are $15 a plant. You can do so by putting your money in the offering plate if you would like to, marking poinsettias, see Amy afterwards to fill out the form, or you can go to the order of service on our website, and at the very end of that order of service, there is a link that you can follow for the purchase of your poinsettias, and then you can give online as well. Third, if you would like to offer a Christmas greeting to your Covenant family and friends, there is a giant Christmas card in the narthex, and you can leave a note on that card. There is a box underneath it where if you would like to make a donation for the money that you saved from stamps and cards, mailing them to your friends here, you can put that money, if you'd like to, in that box. And that money goes to help special needs in our community for those who are in need during the winter season. If you're worshiping virtually with us, you can send me the message and I will be happy to post that for you. You can also give online through our Give button. Just a friendly reminder, our website is www.covenantlb.org, and just a lot that I just told you. So if you have any questions or problems, just reach out to me in person or go to my email at alangworthy@covenantlb.org, and I will be happy to help you out. Next Sunday, we will be having the review of the budget for 2023, and that will be held at 11:50 in the fireside room immediately following Sunday school. So if you'd like to stay in person, you can do so, but if you'd like to join virtually, we will be providing that meeting through Google Meet, and the code will be listed at the end of the order of service for next Sunday. Let us now, with all this business taken care of, totally focus on our Lord and be called into worship.
The Lord our God is our salvation, our strength, and our song. He gathers us together to be glad and of good cheer in his grace. Let us rejoice in worship, beginning in prayer. Holy God, awesome God, you are good as well as great. You feed us in our hunger. You look for us in our lostness. You raise our spirits in our downcast days. May we now turn our eyes upon you and delight in your kindness, generosity, and steadfast love to the praise of your glory. Amen.
Joy is a song that welcomes the dawn, telling the world that the Savior is born. Love is a flame that burns in our hearts. Jesus has come and will
suffering and in need.
Christ will bring us great joy.
For those who have experienced personal loss.
Christ will bring us great joy.
For those who battle daily with inner demons.
Christ will bring us great joy.
For those who endure deep disappointment.
This morning we light three candles. The first symbolizes the hope of Christ's coming. The second, the peace he bestows. And the third, the joy meant for people in every corner of the world. Remarkable joy brought by the birth of your Son is a light to brighten every person's darkness and a spark to illuminate their everyday with joy. May gladness and wonder over Jesus reside in our hearts always and everywhere. We pray this by his mercy and grace. Amen. Let us now rejoice by singing, "Joy to the World, If you're following along in the hymn book, it's number 134. Please stand if you are able.
Seated. And now let us come to our God in prayer. Let us pray. We rejoice and give thanks to you, O God, for sending your Son into the world and your promise that he will come again in all glory. Open our souls that we might more fully welcome him in our hearts now and have eyes open to see blessings. In Jesus' name, amen. Our reading today comes to us from the Gospel of Matthew, the 11th chapter. It's found on page 11 of the New Testament portion of your pew Bible, reading from verses 2 through 6. Listen here for God's Holy Word. When John the Baptist heard in prison what the Messiah was doing, he sent word by his disciples and said to him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for one another?" Jesus answered them, "Go and tell John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the poor have good news brought to them. And blessed is anyone who takes no offense at me." Here ends this reading of God's holy word. All thanks and praise be to our Lord. Amen.
There is an old Jewish saying, if you've got God figured out, it's not God you've figured out. We may know the character of this mysterious God infinitely beyond us and his faithfulness in the history of his dealings with his people, and perhaps in the course of our own personal lives. But as often as not, we don't have a clue as to what exactly God is up to and how he is pursuing his aims. His thoughts are not our thoughts, nor his ways ours, Isaiah said. For example, we may seek to duplicate the joy we used to have at Christmas and hope to have it again by certain means, only to have it by unanticipated means, say, by surprising people. Likewise, we may seek confirmation that we can make a difference for good in this troubled world and hope to verify it in certain terms, only to verify it in unexpected terms, say by surprising, perhaps immeasurable, successes. The prophet John the Baptist once felt sure about Jesus. He saw him as so far greater than he that he deemed himself unworthy even to carry his sandals. And he called him, Jesus, the one who is to come. Back in their days, the most commonly used term to refer to the Messiah promised by God. So, even while in prison, John kept track of Jesus. But the reports he got caused him to wonder whether Jesus was not all he had supposed him to be. The scriptures do not tell us exactly why John had doubts about Jesus. But given his ministry and the way he conducted himself, it's easy to guess. John emphasized the judgment of God upon hypocrites and evil doers, and often himself gave them a taste of it with his verbal lashings. Should we not expect John to be frustrated with Jesus' patience, gentleness, and even acceptance of such bad people? Jesus responded to John's question about him. Now, remember, John was so concerned to know who Jesus was, he had sent a delegation of people to ask Jesus for him, "Are you the one who is to come, or are we to wait for another?" When Jesus responded to that question about Jesus' identity, Jesus only talked about his activity. When John wanted to know who Jesus was, Jesus talked solely about what he was doing. And what Jesus picked up and picked out from all of the activities in which he was engaged makes for a curious list, one that would not satisfy anyone seeking the security of certainty. The actions Jesus cited might have caused John to doubt his doubts some, but they didn't prove anything. Jesus was aware, as John was aware, that several prophets healed miraculously. And so when Jesus told John what he was doing, he mentioned five kinds of healings he did, and then a single theme in his preaching. But because several prophets before Jesus had conducted healings, and one of them, in fact, Elijah, had raised a dead person, they didn't prove that Jesus was more than just another prophet. Yes, the capacity to heal indicated some anointing from God, but no one had thought of any of those prophets as possibly the Messiah. So what is crucial here is the preaching theme Jesus underlined among all his preaching themes to John, because it addressed an issue that lay behind John's doubts. Jesus noted that through his preaching, the poor have good news brought to them. That jives with Jesus' first beatitude, the initial word at the start of his Sermon on the Mount when he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." To whom do all the riches of God's glory and goodness belong? According to Jesus, not every time to those who are especially righteous and have a proven record of doing justice, showing compassion, and embodying integrity, as worthy and wonderful as such practices are. Rather, God's riches belong to any and all who view whatever level of righteousness they have attained as something too paltry and poor to give them any right to God's riches. God's riches, and this is good news, belong to any and all who own up to the reality that their only hope lies in their throwing themselves upon God's mercy, and who get it, that throwing themselves upon God's mercy always involves their throwing themselves under God's lordship as his faithful, obedient children. The righteousness that eventually comes is never the root of their good standing with God, but the fruit of their good standing with God. This good news about God's grace is the best gift or blessing Jesus brought. But that blessing is not always welcomed. Those proud of their own virtue and those who mean to be self-reliant hate it. And I think that if John didn't exactly hate that message, he wasn't at all sure he liked it. Then there's this. While John wanted to know whether Jesus fit into his categories of what God would and should do, Jesus wanted John to look at himself and determine whether he was, in his attitude and focus, fitting into God's chief concern, which is to show his grace to any and all, and to encourage everyone to trust that it can save them from themselves and from their false faith in their self-effort. To believe that we can enjoy God's riches just by responding rightly to God's undeserved, unearnable, and thus unlimited kindness is a source of great joy. The last person you'd ever expect to radiate joy is someone who has suffered from quadriplegia for over 50 years and endured chronic pain for decades. But that's exactly what a hero of mine, Johnny Erickson Tada, does. And she does it by looking to God's grace and embracing the unwelcome blessing her paralysis is. When in her late teens, she had to look at a new life as a paralyzed person, she looked first for God to heal her. But it never happened, except that God healed her of her need to be healed. And God gave her the eyes to see her paralysis as an unwelcome blessing she'd do well to welcome. Johnny now thanks, and that you can see that she does so genuinely. Johnny now thanks it, believe it or not, for her quadriplegia. She does so for two reasons. First, it makes her aware of her own poverty of spirit, keeps her in touch with her need for God, and motivates her to seek a close relationship with God, if only out of desperation, but as the most wonderful gift of her life. Second, her overcoming, by God's grace, the immense, unrelenting difficulties and challenges of her paralysis and emerging out of them with unshakable good cheer gives her a hard-won credibility when she bears witness to the reality and power of God's grace, a credibility that motivates people to listen to her with an open mind. Let us not box up God in our expectations about what he will or should do. Let us welcome even the unwelcome but wise blessings of his grace. For they may, in the end, as they have for Johnny, put our best dreams to shame, fill our souls with joy, and give others ears to hear the good news he brought us and still brings to the poor in spirit. To be poor in spirit is to know our need of God, and to know our need of God and to believe in its possibilities is to be uplifted with glad and rejoicing hearts. Let us now uplift our spirits and our bodies if we are able as we sing Good Christian Friends Rejoice, hymn number 132 in the hymn book.
Give me heed to what we say.
beloved of God. Beloved of God and dear friends, let us pray. Lord Jesus, when you knew no need, but enjoyed all good things to the hilt in heaven, you came down to this benighted world to look for us and save us. When you knew only perfect pleasure in paradise, you entered this bedeviled world to suffer its worst for our sake. When you resided among the holy, you moved into our neighborhood to show us God's mercy. May we give thanks for your love by embodying it to others in our flesh and actions. May we be evidence of your presence and witnesses to your truth. May we give people a reason to look for you and to open their hearts to you, you who is ever looking for each of us and for a chance to strike up a friendship. We pray today for those confined at home or in institutions by illness, health protocols, disability, or demons of the mind. And we offer ourselves into your service that you might send us to bring them good cheer, high hopes, and loving consolation. Lord Jesus, we sum up our praying now by saying the prayer you taught your followers. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us glory in the God who got down to our level, who got eyeball to eyeball with us, so we would believe in his love. Please stand, if you are able, as we glorify in this God, singing Angels We Have Heard on High, number 3113 in your hymn book.
After the benediction, if you would please be seated to receive the postlude today. Thank you so much to God for sending Jesus into the world. Thank you so much to God for giving us reason to have joy. May we go forth filled with that thanksgiving to our God as we live our days. Amen. Please be seated.